over the past 28 years that I've pastored at Calvary, there have been dozens of times, gang. Oh, that's what I call my church, gang. Is that okay? Dozens of times that I have referred people to another church. I mean, maybe they're not happy with us, or they moved to a different area, or, you know, there's lots of reasons. But let's say, hey, can you help me find a church? We need to go to another church. And I'll say, oh, yeah, the Baptist church down there, the Evangelical Free, the community church, maybe, you know, what other church? You know, sure, you'll get plugged in there. God will bless you. But I want you to ask an Adventist pastor when the last time was he referred a Christian, a visitor, or one of his church members to a non-Adventist church. Hello, when was the last time? Tell me. Never. Well, that offends me. If you want to be an evangelical, why won't you let evangelicals into your church? Good question. At this point in times in Earth's history, they acknowledge that there are some real sincere Christians in other churches. But all other churches are sincerely wrong. They believe that for now, the words of Jesus in John 10:16 apply to those of us who are not Adventists. I have sheep, other sheep, which are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will hear my voice, and they will become one flock with one shepherd. John 10. But the Adventist understanding of this verse goes like this. I have other sheep, which are not of this fold. Adventism. I must bring them also into Adventism, and they will hear my voice. The SDA message. And they will become one flock. Part of the remnant church with one shepherd. That's what they think of you. You need to understand that. They believe that when the going gets tough in the last days, the really true believers in other churches, they're in other churches right now, they will leave and they will become Seventh-day Adventists. I don't want to belabor this point, but it's very important and foundational to understanding Adventism. Beneath the kindness and sense of openness you feel as you talk with them, there is a sense, and please, there's a sense of superiority. We know more than you know, and every single thing that is done as a witness to you. I mowed my lawn and kept it green as a witness. I didn't eat meat in front of others as a witness. I mean, everything you do is hoping that somebody else is going to become a Seventh-day Adventist. I suppose the way we feel like, we want you to become a Christian. In fact, they'll even say, pastors, other people that aren't Adventists, they'll say among themselves, oh man, wouldn't she make the greatest Adventist? Yeah. Wouldn't Billy Graham? I could tell you a story there. That's the DNA of Adventism. But the Bible teaches that if we are saved, we have been baptized into one body, one church. There's one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God who's over all. There aren't all these little bazillion churches in God's sight. There's one true church, and it's made up of all Christians. And they even acknowledge that we're Christians. So, what does that mean? Seventh-day Adventism can never be evangelical. Another Adventist also insists that they, like other churches, believe the Bible alone is a source of authority. This is what the statement of faith says. The Holy Scriptures, Old and New Testaments, are written word of God, given by divine inspiration, through holy men of God who spoke and wrote as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. In this word, God has committed to man the knowledge necessary for salvation. The Holy Scriptures are the infallible revelation of his will. Notice it does not say the only infallible revelation. My statement of doctrine at my church and at your churches is the only revelation of God's will. I mean, you got to read between the lines here, you guys. Scriptures are the infallible revelation of his will. They are the standard of, listen, character, the test of experience, and the trustworthy record of God's acts in history. This sounds good, but it's a beautiful facade. It gives you an illusion. Oh, great, they believe in the Bible. Yes, they believe in the Bible, but not alone. Not alone. Seventh-day Adventists also believe that what marks them as a remnant, only true church, is that they have a Latter-day prophet, Ellen G. White. Her writings are also an authoritative source of truth. The church does not believe that the Bible alone is the only source of authority and truth for the church. And I know some of you, you're guests, and you've been irritated with me some, but you also have to know I'm a really nice guy, and you knew that in your heart too, right? And the other thing is, right here, right now, I know the Lord is speaking to you because you know what I'm saying, and it is a question. Yeah, we do believe the Bible only, but how can I believe the Bible only, but I also believe that Ellen White is just like the Bible? The church does not believe that the Bible alone is the only source of authority and truth for the church. Listen to point 18 of their doctrinal statement. It's titled The Gift of Prophecy. One of the gifts of the Holy Spirit is prophecy. This gift is an identifying mark of the remnant church, was manifested in the ministry of Ellen G. White, as the Lord's messenger. Her writings are how did they say the Bible was in the last statement? Her writings are a continuing and authoritative source of truth, which provide for the church, sounds like the Bible here, comfort, guidance, instruction, and correction. They also make it clear, this kills me here, they also make it clear that the Bible is the standard by which all teaching and experience must be tested. Wait, you just told me her writings are the standard of comfort, guidance, instruction, correction, authoritative source of truth. I've got a contradiction here going here. The Adventist Church does not believe the Bible is the only source of authority. Christian pastors, Christian leaders, Bible study leaders, friends of Adventists, got to understand this. Ellen White's writings are an authoritative source of truth. Her writings are considered to be as inspired as the Bible. Her writings are part of their hermeneutic. Remember what the conference president said? They are part of the hermeneutic for interpreting the scripture. Her writings are considered to be as inspired as the Bible. Her writings interpret the Bible for you. And I'll tell you, that's spelled this way. You can never disagree with Ellen White and be right. If you disagree with Ellen White, you are, finish it, wrong. You're wrong. Ever go to a Sabbath school class? Man, I got all these Bible texts. Someone pulls out an Ellen White text and it's done. I bow. You know what I mean? I give, uncle, you know, whatever, because she's the final say. And you got to understand that, because people will understand this is one of the behind the facade. Looks so good, so pretty, so clean. The inside has not changed. This brings us to the Adventist view of the Bible. There can be no doubt that the Bible itself claims that every word in every part of it is inspired by God. Do you believe that? Yes. Every single word. Jesus reinforced the accuracy of the scriptures by saying that even down to the smallest word, the smallest point of punctuation is inspired by God. This view of the scripture is often referred to as the verbal plenary inspiration. Here's what this means. The inspiration of the Holy Spirit extends to the very words themselves. That's verbal. Not just to concepts or ideas, that the inspiration of the scripture extends to all parts of scripture, to all subject matters in the scriptures. That's plenary. And full verbal plenary inspiration of the scriptures is essential to understanding the authority of the Word of God. In its original text, the Word was infallible and inerrant. Infallible means incapable of error. Inerrant means totally free from error. That's the book that God gave over the 1,500 years or 2,000 years that the Scripture was given by the Holy Spirit. Now, if you were to poll a large group of Seventh-day Adventists listening to what I just said about the Bible, they would agree with this wholeheartedly. I totally believe that with all my heart. Yet the official doctrine of their church is just the opposite of this view. I know the Adventist folks I know throughout my life, they heard what I just said, they go, amen. That the Adventist church teaches that God gave the prophets and apostles only thoughts to write down, not the words themselves. But Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by what? Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. He gave the words. Another thing that would shock most Adventists is that the church does not believe in the inerrancy of Scripture. The church teaches that some of the Bible writers made mistakes. They believe their view of inspiration, this is really good, this just hit me. You probably knew this all along. But their view of inspiration works backwards. They believe Ellen White was a prophet, and they feel they have an advantage of having a modern prophet among them, and they're not left to struggle with how inspiration works. What she did or not do, the apostles and prophets must have done. That's the reasoning. If she made mistakes and prophecies that didn't come through, well, that's the way inspiration works. If she plagiarized from others and claimed the words to be those of an angel, you know, then that's the way the prophets worked.